English Fairy Tales, collected by Joseph Jacobs, narrated by Luana Maranz. Binary. Once upon a time, there were two king's daughters lived in a bower near the bony, mild dams of Binary. And Sir William came wooing the eldest and won her love and plighted troth with glove and with ring. But after a time, he looked upon the youngest with her cherry cheeks and golden hair, and his love grew towards her till he cared no longer for the eldest one. So she hated her sister for taking away Sir William's love, and day by day her hate grew upon her, and she plotted and she planned how to get rid of her. So one fine morning, fair and clear, she said to her sister, "Let us go and see our father's boats come in at the bony mill stream of Binary." So they went there hand in hand, and when they got to the river's bank, the youngest got upon a stone to watch for the coming of the boats, and her sister, coming behind her, caught her round the waist and dashed her into the rushing millstream of Binary. "Oh, sister, sister, reach me your hand," she cried as she floated away, "and you shall have half of all I've got or shall get." "No, sister, I'll reach you no hand of mine, for I am the heir to all your land. Shame on me if I touch the hand that has come 'twixt me and my own heart's love." "Oh, sister, sister, then reach me your glove," she cried as she floated further away, "and you shall have your William again." "Sink on," cried the cruel princess. "No hand or glove of mine you'll touch. Sweet William will be all mine when you are sunk beneath the bony mill stream of Binary." And she turned and went home to the king's castle. And the princess floated down the mill stream, sometimes swimming and sometimes sinking, till she came near the mill. Now the miller's daughter was cooking that day and needed water for her cooking. And as she went to draw it from the stream, she saw something floating towards the mill dam. And she called out, "Father, father, draw your dam. There's something white, a merry maid or a mill white swan, coming down the stream." So the miller hastened to the dam and stopped the heavy, cruel mill wheels. And then they took out the princess and laid her on the bank. Fair and beautiful she looked as she lay there. In her golden hair were pearls and precious stones. You could not see her waist, for her golden girdle and the golden fringe of her white dress came down over her lily feet. But she was drowned, drowned! And as she lay there in her beauty, a famous harper passed by the mill dam of Binary's and saw her sweet pale face. And though he traveled on far away, he never forgot that face, and after many days he came back to the bony mill stream of Binary. But then all he could find of her, where they had put her to rest, were her bones and her golden hair. So he made a harp out of her breastbone and her hair and traveled on up the hill from the mill dam of Binary, till he came to the castle of the king, her father. That night, they were all gathered in the castle hall to hear the great harper, king and queen, their daughter and son, Sir William, and all their court. And first the harper sang to his old harp, making them joy and be glad or sorrow and weep, just as he liked. But while he sang, he put the harp he had made that day on a stone in the hall, and presently it began to sing by itself, low and clear, and the harper stopped, and all were hushed. And this was what the harp sung. "Oh, yonder sits my father the king, Binary, oh, Binary, and yonder sits my mother the queen, by the bony mill dams of Binary. And yonder stands my brother, Binnery, oh, Binnery. And by him my William falls and true, by the bony mill dams of Binnery. Then they all wondered, and the harper told them how he had seen the princess lying drowned on the bank near the bony mill dams of Binnery, and how he had afterwards made this harp out of her hair and breastbone. Just then the harp began singing again, and this was what it sang out loud and clear. And there sits my sister who drowned me by the bony mill dams of Binnery. And the harp snapped and broke and never sang more. Cap o' Rushes. Well, there was once a very rich gentleman, and he'd three daughters, and he thought he'd see how fond they were of him. So he says to the first, "How much do you love me, my dear?" "Why," says she, "as I love my life." "That's good," says he. So he says to the second, "How much do you love me, my dear?" "Why," says she, "better nor all the world." "That's good," says he. So he says to the third, "How much do you love me, my dear?" "Why, I love you as fresh meat loves salt," says she. Well, he was that angry. "You don't love me at all," says he, "and in my house you stay no more." So he drove her out there and then and shut the door in her face. Well, she went away on and on till she came to a fen, and there she gathered a lot of rushes and made them into a kind of a sort of a cloak with a hood to cover her from head to foot and to hide her fine clothes. And then she went on and on till she came to a great house. "Do you want a maid?" says she. "No, we don't," said they. "I haven't nowhere to go," says she, "and I ask no wages and do any sort of work," says she. "Well," says they, "if you like to wash the pots and scrape the saucepans, you may stay," said they. So she stayed there and washed the pots and scraped the saucepans and did all the dirty work. And because she gave no name, they called her Cap o' Rushes. Well, one day there was to be a great dance a little way off, and the servants were allowed to go and look on at the grand people. Cap o' Rushes said she was too tired to go, so she stayed at home. But when they were gone, she offed with her cap o' rushes and cleaned herself and went to the dance, and no one there was so finely dressed as her. Well, who should be there but her master's son, and what should he do but fall in love with her the minute he set eyes on her? He wouldn't dance with anyone else. But before the dance was done, Cap o' Rushes slipped off, and away she went home. And when the other maids came back, she was pretending to be asleep with her Cap o' Rushes on. Well, next morning they said to her, "You did miss a sight, Cap o' Rushes." "What was that?" says she. "Why, the beautifulest lady you ever see, dressed right gay and gaw. The young master, he never took his eyes off her." "Well, I should have liked to have seen her," says Cap o' Rushes. "Well, there's to be another dance this evening, and perhaps she'll be there." But come the evening, Cap o' Rushes said she was too tired to go with them. Howsoever, when they were gone, she offed with her Cap o' Rushes and cleaned herself, and away she went to the dance. The master's son had been reckoning on seeing her, and he danced with no one else and never took his eyes off her. But before the dance was over, she slipped off and home she went. And when the maids came back, she pretended to be asleep with her Cap o' Rushes on. Next day, they said to her again, "Well, Cap o' Rushes, You should have been there to see the lady. There she was again, gay and gay, and the young master, he never took his eyes off her. Well there, says she, I should have liked to have seen her. Well, says they, there's a dance again this evening, and you must go with us, for she's sure to be there. Well, come this evening, Caporushes said she was too tired to go, and do what they would, she stayed at home. But when they were gone, she offed with her caporushes and cleaned herself, and away she went to the dance. The master's son was rarely glad when he saw her. He danced with none but her and never took his eyes off her. When she wouldn't tell him her name, nor where she came from, he gave her a ring and told her if he didn't see her again, he should die. Well, before the dance was over, off she slipped, and home she went. And when the maids came home, she was pretending to be asleep with her caporushes on. Well, the next day they says to her, there, caporushes, you didn't come last night, and now you won't see the lady, for there is no more dances. Well, I should have rarely liked to have seen her, says she. The master's son, he tried every way to find out where the lady was gone, but go where he might and ask whom he might, he never heard anything about her. And he got worse and worse for the love of her, till he had to keep his bed. Make some gruel for the young master, they said to the cook. He's dying for the love of the lady. The cook, she set about making it when caporushes came in. What are you a-doing of? Says she. I'm going to make some gruel for the young master, says the cook, for he's dying for love of the lady. Let me make it, says caporushes. Well, the cook wouldn't at first, but at last she said yes, and caporushes made the gruel. And when she had made it, she slipped the ring into it on the sly before the cook took it upstairs. The young man, he drank it, and then he saw the ring at the bottom. Send for the cook, says he. So up she comes. Who made this gruel here? Says he. I did, says the cook, for she was frightened. And he looked at her. No, you didn't, says he. Say who did it, and you shan't be harmed. Well then, 'twas caporushes, says she. Send caporushes here, says he. So caporushes came. Did you make my gruel? Says he. Yes, I did, says she. Where did you get this ring? Says he. From him that gave it to me, says she. Who are you then? Says the young man. I'll show you, says she. And she offed with her caporushes, and there she was in her beautiful clothes. Well, the master's son, he got well very soon, and they were to be married in a little time. It was to be a very grand wedding, and everyone was asked far and near, and Caporush's father was asked, but she never told anybody who she was. But before the wedding, she went to the cook, and says she, I want you to dress every dish without a mite of salt. That'll be rare nasty, says the cook. That doesn't signify, says she. Very well, says the cook. Well, the wedding day came, and they were married, and after they were married, all the company sat down to the dinner. When they began to eat the meat, that was so tasteless they couldn't eat it. But Caporushes' father, he tried first one dish and then another, and then burst out crying. What is the matter? Said the master's son to him. Oh, says he, I had a daughter, and I asked her how much she loved me. And she said, as much as fresh meat loves salt. And I turned her from my door, for I thought she didn't love me. And now I see she loved me best of all, and she may be dead for aught I know. No, father, here she is, says Caporushes, and she goes up to him and puts her arms around him. And so they were happy ever after. Child Roland. Child Roland and his brothers twain were playing at the ball, and there was their sister, Bird Ellen, in the midst among them all. Child Roland kicked it with his foot and caught it with his knee. At last, as he plunged among them all, o'er the church he made it flee. Bird Ellen round about the aisle to seek the ball is gone, but long they waited and longer still, and she came not back again. They sought her east, they sought her west, they sought her up and down, and woe were the hearts of those brethren, for she was not to be found. So at last her eldest brother went to the warlock Merlin and told him all the case and asked him if he knew where Bird Ellen was. The fair Bird Ellen, said the warlock Merlin, must have been carried off by the fairies because she went round the church, wider shins, the opposite way to the sun. She is now in the dark tower of the king of Elfland. It would take the boldest knight in Christendom to bring her back. If it is possible to bring her back, said her brother, I'll do it or perish in the attempt. Possible it is, said the warlock Merlin, but woe to the man or mother's son that attempts it, if he is not well taught before what he is to do. The eldest brother of Bird Ellen was not to be put off by any fear of danger from attempting to get her back. So he begged the warlock Merlin to tell him what he should do and what he should not do in going to seek his sister. And after he had been taught and had repeated his lesson, he set out for Elfland. But long they waited and longer still with doubt and muckle pain. But woe were the hearts of his brethren, for he came not back again. Then the second brother got tired and sick of waiting, and he went to the warlock Merlin and asked him the same as his brother. So he set out to find Bird Ellen. But long they waited and longer still with muckle doubt and pain. And woe were his mother's and brother's heart, for he came not back again. And when they had waited and waited a good long time, Child Roland, the youngest of Bird Ellen's brothers, wished to go and went to his mother, the good queen, to ask her to let him go. But she would not at first, for he was the last of her children she now had, and if he was lost, all would be lost. But he begged and he begged till at last the good queen let him go and gave him his father's good brand that he never struck in vain. And as she girt it round his waist, she said the spell that would give it victory. So Child Roland said goodbye to the good queen, his mother, and went to the cave of the warlock Merlin. Once more, and but once more, he said to the warlock, tell how man or mother's son may rescue Bird Ellen and her brothers twain. Well, my son, said the warlock Merlin, there are but two things, simple they may seem, but hard they are to do. One thing to do, and one thing not to do, and the thing to do is this. After you have entered the land of fairy, whoever speaks to you, till you meet the bird Ellen, you must out with your father's brand and off with their head. And what you've not to do is this, bite no bit and drink no drop, however hungry or thirsty you be. Drink a drop or bite a bit while in Elfland you be, and never will you see Middle Earth again. So Child Roland said the two things over and over again, till he knew them by heart, and he thanked the warlock Merlin, and went on his way, and he went along, and along, and along, and still further along, till he came to the horse herd of the king of Elfland feeding his horses. These he knew by their fairy eyes, and knew that he was at last in the land of fairy. "Canst thou tell me," said Child Roland to the horse herd, "where the king of Elfland's dark tower is?" "I cannot tell thee," said the horse herd, "but go on a little further, and thou wilt come to the cow herd, and he, maybe, can tell thee." Then, without a word more, Child Roland drew the good brand that never struck in vain, and off went the horse herd's head, and Child Roland went on further, till he came to the cow herd, and asked him the same question. "I can't tell thee," said he, "but go on a little further, and thou wilt come to the hen wife, and she is sure to know." Then Child Roland, out with his good brand that never struck in vain, and off went the cow herd's head. And he went on a little further till he came to an old woman in a gray cloak, and he asked her if she knew where the dark tower of the king of Elfland was. "Go on a little further," said the henwife, "till you come to a round green hill, surrounded with terrace rings from the bottom to the top. Go round it three times, widder shins, and each time say, 'Open door, open door, and let me come in.' And the third time the door will open and you may go in." And Child Roland was just going on when he remembered what he had to do. So he out with the good brand that never struck in vain, and off went the hen wife's head. Then he went on and on and on till he came to the round green hill with the terrace rings from top to bottom. And he went round it three times, Wandershin saying each time, open door, and let me come in." And the third time the door did open and he went in, and it closed with a click. And Child Roland was left in the dark. It was not exactly dark, but a kind of twilight or gloaming. There were neither windows nor candles, and he could not make out where the twilight came from, if not through the walls and roof. These were rough arches made of a transparent rock, encrusted with sheep silver and rock spar and other bright stones. But though it was rock, the air was quite warm, as it always is in Elfland. So he went through this passage till at last he came to two wide and high folding doors, which stood ajar, and when he opened them, there he saw a most wonderful and glorious sight, a large and spacious hall, so large that it seemed to be as long and as broad as the green hill itself. The roof was supported by fine pillars, so large and lofty that the pillars of a cathedral were as nothing to them. They were all of gold and silver with fretted work, and between them and around them, wreaths of flowers composed of what do you think? Why, of diamonds and emeralds and all manner of precious stones. And the very keystones of the arches had for ornaments clusters of diamonds and rubies and pearls and other precious stones. And all these arches met in the middle of the roof. And just there hung by a gold chain an immense lamp made out of one big pearl, hollowed out and quite transparent. And in the middle of this was a big, huge carbuncle, which kept spinning round and round. And this was what gave light by its rays to the whole hall, which seemed as if the setting sun was shining on it. The hall was furnished in a manner equally grand, and at one end of it was a glorious couch of velvet, silk, and gold. And there sat Bird Ellen, combing her golden hair with a silver comb. And when she saw Child Roland, she stood up and said, "God pity ye, poor luckless fool. What have ye here to do? Hear ye this, my youngest brother. Why didn't ye bide at home? Had you 100,000 lives, ye couldn't spare any a one. But sit ye down, but woe, 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 that ever ye were born. For come the king of Elfland, in your fortune is forlorn." Then they sate down together, and Child Roland told her all that he had done, and she told him how their two brothers had reached the Dark Tower, but had been enchanted by the King of Elfland, and lay there entombed as if dead. And then, after they had talked a little longer, Child Roland began to feel hungry from his long travels, and told his sister Bird Ellen how hungry he was, and asked for some food, forgetting all about the warlock Merlin's warning. Bird Ellen looked at Child Roland sadly and shook her head, but she was under a spell and could not warn him. So she rose up and went out, and soon brought back a golden basin full of bread and milk. Child Roland was just going to raise it to his lips when he looked at his sister and remembered why he had come all the way. So he dashed the bowl to the ground and said, "Not a sup will I swallow, nor a bit will I bite till Bird Ellen is set free." Just at that moment.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.